Shut up, you're ruining the moment. The only thing ruining the moment is your f***ing outfit. What do you mean? It fits my aesthetic. What's your aesthetic? Registered sex offender? I look dark and mysterious. You look like you lured children back to your cabin to play hide the baby carrot. Hey, what's up everybody, I'm Scatteray and welcome to another D&D Green Text video. Before getting into this video, I just want to let you know that I would really appreciate it if you would tell me in the comments any other subreddits that you would like me to read from. Right, that's all, enjoy the video. It's a player doesn't know how their spells work, but assumes they do instead of just looking them up game. It's a player doesn't even know how their class features exist and botch the ones they do session. Oh, I don't add the damage of my weapon to my unarmed attacks. Guess that explains why I've been doing so much damage this 6-month campaign until you pointed that out for me, DM. How can I make a badass no-kill policy character? Be me, ex-soldier turned cleric. Be a specialist in the field of exorcism. Be traveling across the Sword Coast performing exorcism. I don't do it for money. I do it for the happy little people. Anytime there is a possession, you can bet I will be there. My methods would seem unorthodox though. I do not use holy water, holy symbols, or even prayer. All I need is my trusty mace. My mace is my paintbrush. Coat the fiend's soul in pain. All I do is continue to beat the possessed into submission with continuous coats of pain. And after enough coats, the fiend will leave the host to run away in fear from me. I typically heal the victim from the wounds I caused in my assault. Once they are restored, I take my leave. But they always stop to get my name. I tell them it's Robert of the House Ross, and that my mace is my paintbrush. They thank me for beating the devil out of them. How do marshals deal with casters that can fly? The sorcerer hovered 20 feet above the party. He laughs maniacally as he mocks them. Ha ha ha, you fools. None of you can hit me at this altitude. I am untouchable. The halfling rogue looked at the half-orc barbarian. Midget missile? The barbarian smiled. The barbarian picked up the rogue by the collar of his shirt and the belt on his pants. The rogue then unsheathed his daggers. The barbarian then started to spin around. He was performing a hammer throw and the rogue was the hammer. He was gaining speed with each revolution. Now! The barbarian threw the rogue with all his might towards the sorcerer. The rogue flew through the air, sailing at great speed.
Time to clip your wings!
The rogue collided with the sorcerer, jamming his daggers into him. The sorcerer screamed in pain as he lost his concentration on the spell. Both the rogue and the sorcerer plummeted back to the ground. They both took full damage. The sorcerer is now in melee range. Wizard casts Animate Dead. Dude, you shouldn't disturb the dead to create mindless killing machines. That's evil. So what? Nobody cares. Party Paladin cuts him down on the spot. Wow, just like that? You can't just kill me. That's evil. Be me. First time running 5th edition, but years of experience. Teaching the basics of D&D to newbies, all but one. Experienced player is a drow barbarian with bare minimum intelligence. Party comes upon door to their first dungeon. Experienced player asks rogue to check for traps. A good start, though there are none. Roll strength check to hack door down with my axe. Natural 1. The axe head breaks off in the door as it slowly creaks open, unlocked. Experienced player complains at me for being harsh.
It's not my fault you and your character have the same intelligence.
Experienced player throws his dice at me and walks out. My face went. Anyone else have players rage quit? I don't think I've seen anyone rage quit before, but if you have any players rage quitting stories, I'd love to read them in the comments. An ancient neutral awakens. Its effects on the world are neither here nor there. Confess your goodest of deeds. Hug the little girl. I prepare baked goods for my players before every session, and I greet them with tea or coffee when they arrive to play. We catch up, do any leveling or general bookkeeping for the game, and we start playing after we're done. Inside the game? Either when I donated 75,000 gold coins to help build the metropolis, or the time I spent 2 hours talking down a suicide. Outside the game, but TG related? I supply the GM with plenty of material for the adventures and campaigns, yet I'm good at avoiding metagaming when he uses something I wrote. Real life? Nothing worth mentioning. I once waived my healing fee for some kid who couldn't afford it. Helped some star-crossed lovers find a home and get away from their parents. Also had tea with the main villain to talk him out of killing a bunch of people. also helped fix an entire nation's economy. Technically, that was by stealing a ludicrous amount of money, thus deinflating the market, but still, positive in the end. I offered my foil Sorin to my friend's Edgar deck for free. I once bought a Planeswalker intro deck on a whim to a random kid I didn't even knew the name of. The kid was negotiating with the store owner because he clearly wanted that deck and was thinking about selling some of his favorite cards for it. It made his day. I once gave one of my players a home to live in when her parents kicked her out for being gay. Apparently, the King's Messenger wasn't a brain-addled fool. There's the dragon, chained between rocks. There's the sentient tower, hovering on a cloud of mist and levitating pebbles, bristling with ballistae and whatnots. Top two windows glowing like baleful eyes. Apparently, when the King's Messenger said the tower has kidnapped the princess and locked her in a dragon, he wasn't mixing words up. What do? The party looks upon the spectacle before them. They are struck with bewilderment. Kelly breaks the silence.
Amy?
Yeah?
Did you sleep as a LSD or something?
Amy shakes his head. I wish I did. It would have made this sim a lot more normal. They all take a deep breath. What are we getting for this mission? 10 gold. I swear I'm gonna kill that cocked up steward. How do you handle downtime, Anons? Tell me your downtime stories. Granted, all of them would go drinking, but aside from that, it all depends on the class. Barbarian.
Exercise and train with my weapons.
Bard, put on a show for money, or head over to the local tavern to find some to- Cleric, spread the word of God and try to set up a church. Druid, establish a botanical garden in the town or start reforestation around the town. Fighter, perform necessary maintenance on my gear or set up a fight club. Monk, establish a dojo or hone my skills. Paladin, try to do random acts of kindness around town and help establish a guild. Ranger, go hunting for pelts or assist the local bestiary. Rogue, plan a heist or do some assassination work for money. Sorcerer, practice my spells in an attempt to master them. Warlock, try to establish a cold hideout for my patron. Wizard, research spells and perform some experiments of questionable morals or legality. Your character awakens to find themselves tied up. As you look around, you notice a dark figure sitting in front of you. You soon realize they are an assassin. What do you do? Emmy awakens in a cold, dark room. He feels lightheaded and his vision is blurred.
I need to stop drinking.
He suddenly realizes he's tied up to a chair.
The f*** did I do last night?
He then notices a dark figure sitting in a chair.
Please don't be a dude, please don't be a dude.
As his vision recovers, he notices the figure is a man with a scruffy neckbeard, wearing a black trench coat and a hat.
You're finally awake.
Let me start by saying I'm not normally into dudes. You just got me when I was drunk.
I caught you when you were asleep.
Amy then realized he had been kidnapped.
Oh, okay, slightly worse situation.
Amy then looked around and noticed he was in a wooden cabin.
Alright, I got 3 questions. Who are you? Where am I? And why are you dressed like Van Helsing lookalike?
Where you are is not important. What is important is the crimes you have committed.
What are you talking about?
You slaughtered an innocent person.
Okay, to be fair, that old lady shouldn't have been in that cold hideout.
You insulted the royal family.
That whole family was a genetic nightmare.
You killed 3 of the king's best soldiers.
Granted, I overreacted, but in my defense, that captain was racist and I was hangry.
You scared a child.
Alright, I got nothing for that one. I did that.
That is why you stand before me today.
I'm sitting down.
Silence! You're a cancer upon this world. I'm the blade that will cut you out of it.
Oh my god, you're one of those guys.
Indeed I am. I am a dark avenger of those you have wronged. I sense your fear. I feel your anguish.
Please stop.
But do not be afraid, for I will release you from this mortal realm.
Oh my god, did you eat a bunch of knives before you got here or something?
What? No.
Really, you could have fooled me from the amount of age you just vomited.
How dare you insult me? I'm all your victim's retribution. I'm your Omega. I'm...
Seriously, are you going to kill me or keep monologuing? Because if you're going to keep monologuing, you might as well cut me out of this chair so I can kill myself.
Shut up. You're ruining the moment.
The only thing ruining the moment is your f***ing outfit.
What do you mean? It fits my aesthetic.
What's your aesthetic? Registered sex offender?
I look dark and mysterious. You look like you lured children back to your cabin to play hide the baby carrot. You know nothing about me.
Let me guess, you were abandoned as a small child after your parents died in a grisly accident that you caused. Then you grew up in an abusive orphanage where the nuns beat the word of God into you. Then after you grew up, you dedicated your life to killing wrongdoers as a feeble way to atone for your ever-growing sins that you fear will never be sated. So how's my accuracy?
That was a lucky guess.
Anyway, I bet you call yourself some cringe bullshit moniker like Death Hunter.
Huh, no, it's Bloodblade.
Like that's any better?
You know what? I don't have to take this. I'm a professional assassin.
You're not a professional assassin.
How do you know I'm not?
Professional assassin would have noticed that I got my hands free already.
Wait, what?
Amy then casts Firebolt. The bolt hits the assassin in the head, killing him instantly. Amy then unties himself and walks to the cabin's door.
As he leaves, he takes one last look at the assassin's corpse.
Page words.
Alright, that's it for this video. Thank you guys for watching, I hope you enjoyed this. Don't forget to leave a like if you did and subscribe for more. Let me know in the comments if you have any other subreddits you would like me to read from. There's a link below if you want to support the channel on Patreon, if you want to join the Discord channel to chat with other people, and if you want to follow me on Twitch where I live stream. And yeah, that's it. Thanks again for watching and I'll see you next time.
Have a great day, bye.